Pichette Audio presents From Cradle to Stage, stories from the mothers who rocked and raised rock stars. Written by Virginia Hanlon Grohl. Read by the author, with a foreword read by Dave Grohl. This program contains a Mac and PC compatible PDF of photos. Keep listening at the end of the book to hear Virginia and Dave sit down for a conversation about childhood and musical influences.
For Lisa and David, my very own superstars. Preface. The lights in the enormous arena dim, a thunderclap of one drum stroke, and then the roar. The overwhelming surge of young voices screaming their acclamation for this exciting new band with a high-energy drummer. It was Nirvana, and the power hitter behind the drum kit was my son, Dave Grohl. I held my breath. I knew nothing would ever be the same. That roar and that moment signaled the life change that propelled David Grohl from a musician in a van to the cover of Rolling Stone. The little boy who had pounded on homemade drum kits on his unmade bed and played his guitar to the records of Led Zeppelin and the Beatles was now on a big stage, masking his fright by frenetically pounding away. The music that had begun years before in a little suburban house in Virginia was now being heard throughout the world. And I was the mother of a rock star. Had I seen it coming? Of course not. But ours had always been a life full of music. I loved Motown and Mozart. My daughter Lisa collected a wide array of albums by Husker Du, David Bowie, and Neil Young, to name a few, and shared them with us. And David's friends brought records from Metallica and Black Flag and other dangerous-sounding groups to our house. There was always music. We sang together, most often in the car on long trips to visit grandmothers or out-of-state friends, those trips substituting for the vacations and airfares we couldn't afford. Today I would gladly trade a first-class flight to London for one of those happy, just-the-three-of-us car trips. We made up songs, we harmonized, we sang to the radio, and we played games, clapping the rhythm of a song for the other two to identify. Always music. Sunday afternoons often found us at the jazz workshops at One Step Down in Washington, D.C., a dark, smoky room where musicians in town for a Saturday gig would stop by and join the house trio. Everyone really listened there, no talking allowed. It was a gem of a place, now long gone but sorely missed. I've often wondered about the mystical force that urges some of us to listen, to play, to sing, to surround ourselves with music. As time went on and I sat at the sides of larger and larger stages, I became more intrigued. I wanted to talk about it with some of the other mothers whose sons and daughters were sharing those stages. But they weren't to be found at the shows and festivals I attended. Several years ago, at the New Orleans Jazz Festival, as I wondered aloud, "Where are they?" a friend said, "Go find them. You should write a book." So, thanks to Jill Berliner, my stop-complaining-and-do-something friend, my journey began. Since then, I've met remarkable women, all members of this special sorority of mothers of musicians. They've welcomed me into their houses, poured me cups of tea, and told me their stories. We've talked about the challenging energy levels of our supercharged progeny, the music lessons most of them rejected, the schools they endured, the paths they took. We've recalled the times and places that came before the fame, and the family histories that shaped the backgrounds of our beloved superstars. I have loved every minute of it. I hope to share this collection of vastly different life stories with listeners who are interested in the trials and joys of raising creative children and with those who are curious about how one generation's story forms the basis for the creators of the next.
Foreword by David Eric Grohl. Every musician remembers his first lesson. That moment when you feel the spark of inspiration ignite and your entire world catches fire. The rush of revelation. the earth-rattling epiphany that music is no longer just a sound, it's every breath you'll ever take again. A puzzle you'll never solve, though you hold all the pieces. An addiction that you'll never kick, though you've been given the antidote. A religion that won't forgive, though it feels like heaven. That moment when you're handed the key to an alternative universe where everything is beautiful, everything is free, and nothing will ever be quite the same again. For some, the first day of the rest of their lives. Mine? Well, there was no classroom, no conservatory, no sheet music or baton. No, it was in the front seat of a beige Ford Maverick rolling through Springfield, Virginia on a sweltering hot summer day in 1975. My teacher? My mother, Miss Virginia Hanlon Grohl. I remember that drive to Pohick Bay, sun on my freckled six-year-old face, wind blowing through my shaggy hair as the legendary Carly Simon's "You're So Vain" played over the crackly old AM radio. My mother and I were smiling and singing along, as we always did, above the booming roar of the open windows, and as Mick Jagger's unmistakable voice joined the chorus, our voices split into harmony for the first time. My mother started singing Mick's lower line as I sang Carly's high lead vocal. Without realizing it, I was harmonizing, just as they do in the song. My heart lit up, my eyes widened, and then something clicked. The sound of our two voices, singing two different melody lines, made me realize one of music's most basic principles. Different notes, when sung together in harmony, create a chord. This moment has burned in my heart and mind as my first love. It's the Michelangelo in my Sistine Chapel, my baptism, my musical Big Bang, if you will. Hell, this was the chicken and the egg. From that moment on, I heard life with an entirely new set of ears. I scoured the radio for harmony. I searched every record in the house to find more. Did every song have this amazing new trick I'd just learned? Did everyone know about this? Had this been going on forever? Why hadn't anyone bothered to tell me? Songs became more than songs. They became my toys. They became my puzzles. They became challenges and mysteries. Some became my best friends. Some became my worst enemies. I was fascinated, enraptured, obsessed. I was hooked. That summer drive to the bay in our Ford Maverick took place over 40 years ago, but that same feeling has never gone away. To this day, when the radio turns on, so do I. Music becomes my everything. I hear structure and composition, arrangement and shape, layers of rhythm. I hear the voice of an artist through his instrument, stories without words. I can carry on a conversation with someone as I drive down the highway, but if there's a song on the radio, I'm probably more focused on the kick drum pattern of the music than on what they're saying to me. Yes, it's that bad. DNA is a miraculous thing. We all carry traits of people we've never met somewhere deep within our chemistry. I'm no scientist, but I believe that my musical abilities are proof of this. There's no divine intervention here. This is flesh and blood. This is something that comes from the inside out. The day I picked up a guitar and played Deep Purple's Smoke on the Water by ear, I knew that all I needed was that DNA and a whole lot of patience, something my mother clearly had an abundance of. These ears and this heart and mind were born of someone. Someone who shared that same love of music and song. I was blessed with a genetic symphony waiting to perform. All it took was that spark. But beyond any biological information, there is love, something that defies all science and reason. And that I am most fortunate to have been given. It's maybe the most defining factor in anyone's life, surely an artist's greatest muse. And there's no love like a mother's love. It is life's greatest song. We're all indebted to the women who have given us life, for without them, there would be no music.
Marianne Stipe, mother of Michael Stipe of R.E.M. Several miles outside Athens, Georgia, in a rural area, where houses sit far back from the road. I drove through the blazing autumnal canopy that surrounded the home of Marianne and John Stipe. There I was greeted by a woman with a slightly familiar face framed by curly gray hair. The resemblance to her son Michael was instantly apparent. The house is small and cozy, with an inviting screened-in back porch, a place to cool off on a hot Georgia day and look at the pond below. Antique church pews and an old merchant's table line the wall. It's a charming...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.